this House Democratic Policy Committee hearing. Today, we're going to be talking about the waters of Pennsylvania. We're here at the request of Representative Mary Jo Daley. We have actually, amazingly, have members from the three major watersheds in the state of Pennsylvania up here with us today. We'll get members to introduce themselves, and then Mary Jo, if you want to make any opening comments, we can. I'll start over here on my left.
State Representative Sarah Nimrato, I represent the 21st District, which is the city of Pittsburgh and northern Allegheny County.
I'm State Representative Mike Sturla. I chair the Democratic Policy Committee, and I'm from Lancaster.
Mary Jo Daley, I represent a district in Montgomery County. Not all of it, not all of the county, but just a small part.
Hi, I'm Representative Christine Howard. I'm from the 167th in the easternmost part of Chester County.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Mike Zabel, representing the 163rd District in Delaware County.
Mary Jo.
Thank you, Chairman. So I want to thank you all for attending this Democratic Policy Committee hearing on Waters of Pennsylvania, also referred to as WOPA. I'm not exactly sure how we're supposed to say that, but my inspiration for this policy hearing came after the Trump administration formally repealed the Clean Water Rule, also known as the Waters of the United States Rule, on September 12, 2019. For background, the Clean Water Act passed in 1972 defines how the EPA regulates the pollutants in our nation's surface waters, including lakes, rivers, streams, wetlands, and coastal areas. However, it did not clearly define which waters are federal. Created in 2015, the WOTUS rule clarified this shortcoming. The purpose of WOTUS was to prevent legal disputes and ease permitting requirements for the multiple levels of government and private entities. By repealing this regulation, we now are subjected to legal confusion and opened opportunities for pollution. Here in Pennsylvania, we are incredibly fortunate to have plentiful water resources that serve our people and our economy. But we also have challenges from stormwater and agricultural runoff creating pollution hazards, fracking wastewater and leachate from landfills, and challenges from a legislative environment that cuts budgets and therefore staffing for regulatory agencies such as DEP and undervalues the relationship between a clean, healthy environment and Pennsylvania's economy, jobs, tourism, and outdoor recreation. In eastern and central Pennsylvania, we have strong partners in compacts involving our neighboring states and the federal government, resulting in the Delaware River Basin Authority and the Susquehanna River Basin Authority. Unfortunately, our western regions do not have similar compacts. As legislators, we cannot take water quality for granted. Our lives, our economy, and our future are at risk. We must understand the challenges and support and pass legislation and annual budgets that rise to these challenges. Water is essential to life, living, and the pursuit of happiness. Our Green Amendment protects it in Pennsylvania, but we as legislators have a responsibility to ensure that our policies reflect an understanding that we also protect our waters. As you can see from our agenda for today's hearing, we have three panels with speakers responsible for regulation, conservation, recreation, and advocacy. We've asked our speakers to keep their comments to no more than 7 minutes to allow for ample Q&A. But before we start, I wanted to extend special thanks to Jackie Bonomo from Penn Future for suggesting holding a policy hearing when I just happened to run into her one day in Philadelphia, and to all of our speakers for sharing your interest and expertise in Waters of Pennsylvania. Thank you. So, you want to?
Sure.
Great.
Thanks. I'll point out we've been joined by Representative Joe Webster from Montgomery County. I will also say that even though Representative Daley said 7 minutes, the agenda says you only have 5 minutes. So, our first panel is Annika Atkinson, Deputy Secretary for Water Programs with the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection, Matthew Kiefer, Assistant State Forester with Pennsylvania Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. You all can start coming up. Ann Pizzeri-Swanson, Executive Director of the Chesapeake Bay Commission. Andrew DeHoff, Executive Director of the Susquehanna River Basin Commission. Andrew Gavin, Deputy Director of the Susquehanna River Basin Commission. And Michael Nerozzi, Director of Policy and Planning with the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission.
Good morning.
Annika, I think we'll start with you.
All Good morning. Good morning, Chairman Sturla, Co-Chair Daley, and members of the committee. On behalf of the Department of Environmental Protection, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to discuss the department's efforts to protect and restore the Commonwealth's water resources, which include over 85,000 miles of rivers, streams, and hundreds of square miles of lakes, ponds, wetlands, bays, and estuaries. The department's statewide water program, consisting of the Bureau of Clean Water and clean water programs in six regional offices, carry out the majority of the activities protecting and restoring clean water in Pennsylvania. There are four key components of the department's statewide clean water program that serve to protect and restore our waters. First, the department develops water quality standards, including designating and existing uses for surface waters. Second, the department monitors and assesses the health of our waters to determine whether they are meeting their designated and existing uses. Third, the department issues permits for activities involving the discharge of pollutants in a manner that is intended to maintain and restore the uses of our waters. Fourth, the department inspects the activities covered by permits and insurance compliance. This process provides a cycle of continuous analysis and feedback that the department uses to inform decision making. I would like to explain the first and second components of this process in more detail because we often receive a lot of questions. The department develops water quality standards for all surface waters of the Commonwealth, which are codified in Chapter 93 of the Pennsylvania Code. These standards consist of both designated uses and parameter-specific criteria necessary to protect those uses. Aquatic life uses includes warm water fishes, also known as WWF, and trout stocking, TSF, cold water fishes, CWF, and migratory fishes, MF. Special protection uses includes high quality waters, also known as HQ, and exceptional value waters, also known as EV. The department will also evaluate requests for use redesignation when it receives a petition that is accepted by the Environmental Quality Board, or when a request is received by another agency, such as the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. In addition, routine aquatic life use surveys may indicate that existing uses of water is different than their designated use. For example, a stream designated for cold water fishes may be assessed to have an existing use of high quality cold water fishes. As part of the process to consider stream redesignation, the department offers opportunities for the public to provide data and information during the evaluation process. First, the department provides public notice of its intent to assess a candidate stream. The department notices requesting additional water quality data for the stream are published in the Pennsylvania Bulletin. Direct mailings are sent to applicable stakeholders, and notices are posted on the department's website. Once the data solicitations are completed, the department prepares a draft stream evaluation report and makes it available for public comment. Comments are received, and the report is updated to address those comments. The report and recommendations are included in a proposed rulemaking and presented to the Environmental Quality Board. In this way, the designated uses in Chapter 93 are continuously evaluated and updated as needed. Regarding monitoring and assessment, the second key components of the clean water program, the department is required under sections 303D and 305B of the Federal Clean Water Act to monitor and assess surface waters and to prepare a report every 2 years on the health of our waters. This report, which is called the Integrated Water Quality Monitoring and Assessment Report, or as we like to call it, the Integrated Report, a lot less words, was last completed in 2018. The 2018 Integrated Report covers the current status of Pennsylvania's waters and summarizes various programs in place to protect and improve water quality. Although reporting for the Clean Water Act has a long history, the department's 2018 report was the first time that the Integrated Report was entirely in an interactive format. It's actually the first in the state. This interactive format offers the ability to convey tremendous amounts of information in a way that is much more easier to understand. The department assesses most streams for four uses, which are aquatic life, recreation, potable water supply, and fish consumption. Overall, approximately 30% of Pennsylvania streams are considered impaired for at least one of the four main categories. Agriculture is the leading known source of stream impairments in Pennsylvania, causing the impairment of about 6,000 stream miles in Pennsylvania, closely followed by abandoned mine drainage. Impairments are not distributed equally throughout Pennsylvania. Lancaster, for example, has 90% of its stream miles impaired for at least one of the four main uses, while northern and more forested counties have far fewer impaired miles. This distribution of impairments has particular impacts for where restoration efforts should occur in Pennsylvania, including targeting Pennsylvania's efforts to restore the bay. Half of Pennsylvania's land area drains the Chesapeake Bay, and Pennsylvania comprises 35% of the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed. The Susquehanna River alone resides mostly in Pennsylvania and contributes about 50% of the total freshwater flow to the bay. When waters are determined to be impaired, the next step in restoring the water typically is the development of a total maximum daily load, or TMDL, similar to the TMDL that EPA finalized for the Chesapeake Bay in 2010. The Chesapeake Bay TMDL establishes limits on the amount of sediment and nutrients that may be discharged to the bay through local waters. Many of these local waters in Pennsylvania are also impaired for sediment and nutrients. For the Phase 3 Chesapeake Bay Watershed Implementation Plan, or WIP, EPA in particular focused on curbing the amount of nutrients, especially total nitrogen and waters entering the bay. Wastewater treatment plants have significantly reduced their outputs of total nitrogen over the past decade, and the largest remaining contributor to total nitrogen load is the agricultural sector. There are seven main priority initiatives within the agricultural sector of Pennsylvania's Phase 3 Chesapeake Bay WIP. These initiatives include compliance with state requirements to minimize soil erosion and manage manure, implementing soil health practices like planting cover crops and using no-till and minimum till planting, utilizing enhanced nutrient management practice like the 4R nutrient stewardship, right source, right rate, right time, right place, implementing manure storage facilities where needed, tracking and reporting dairy precision feeding, eliminating and identifying areas for productive use of excess nutrients, and planning and maintaining grassed and forested stream buffers. These initiatives not only improve water quality, but also aim to improve the stability of the agricultural lands and operations. These initiatives are not new and are known by the industry to be best, most meaningful practices to implement on their farms to increase sustainability and profitability. In fact, these initiatives that I described identify in our Phase 3 WIP were developed in close and extensive consultation with representatives of the agricultural sector. As we move Pennsylvania's Phase 3 WIP from planning to action, the department is continuing to work with the Department of Agriculture and the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, and with teams in each county to develop and implement a strategy to succeed in restoring local waters while cleaning up the bay. Now, I know we're running low on time, so I'll skip a few parts and kind of talk about what we're doing as it relates to investing and cleaning up our waters. An important part of ensuring progress in implementing Pennsylvania's Phase 3 WIP is investment of significant resources. To this end, the department is utilizing three different state grant programs: the Phase 3 WIP Chesapeake Bay County Action-Wide Plan Implementation Grants will fund the community clean water coordinators for Tier 1 and Tier 2 counties, and will include money to be applied for and allotted by each county team's leader, Growing Greener, National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. Pennsylvania Local Government Improvement Grants are two additional grant programs that will be used to support these efforts. Other state and federal funding opportunities include, but are not limited to, resource enhancement and protection programs, also known as REAP, Conservation Excellent Grants, PennVest. We have the Natural Resource Conservation Service funding, like EQIP, and the Regional Conservation Program, Partnership Program. So, in summary, the department maintains a deliberate and iterative process to protect and restore water quality through its statewide clean water program. and in the department's approach to implementing its responsibilities under the Chesapeake Bay TMDL. There is no question that over the past few decades, federal and state water quality programs have cleaned up many rivers and streams across the Commonwealth, but the reality is that many of Pennsylvania's toughest challenges lie ahead. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present for you guys this morning, and I'll open it up for questions.
Thank you. We'll take testimony from everybody, and then we'll ask everyone questions. Mr. Kiefer?
Okay. Good morning, Chair Sturla, Co-Chair Daley, and members of the committee. My name is Matt Kiefer. I'm with the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, Bureau of Forestry. And in Pennsylvania, we manage Pennsylvania's 121 state parks, our 2.2 million acres of state forest, and we also provide grant funding and technical assistance to communities and landowners to help conserve and improve their properties. Today, I look forward to discussing with you the connections among our forest, water quality and habitat, and providing recreational opportunities. In Pennsylvania, we are fortunate to have nearly 17 million acres of forest covering about 60% of the Commonwealth. 30% of this forest is publicly owned by agencies like DCNR, the Game Commission, and the U.S. Forest Service. The remaining 70%, or about 12 million acres, is privately owned by families and individuals. These forests provide many critical values to the Commonwealth, including clean air, plant and wildlife habitat, wood products, and jobs to support the state's $16 billion forest products industry, and carbon sequestration and climate change mitigation. In urban areas, trees improve aesthetics and increase property values and provide many human health benefits. From a water perspective, in rural areas, forested watersheds produce the cleanest water of any land use, and in urban areas, trees to help mitigate stormwater impacts and remove pollutants from our waterways. Especially important are the areas directly adjacent to streams and rivers, which we call riparian areas. These streamside forests provide buffer zones between the waterways and adjacent agricultural and developed lands, both of which contribute pollution runoff. These streamside forests also provide habitat to many wildlife species and help to improve the habitat conditions for aquatic organisms in the waterways, and they help to reduce the frequency and intensity of flooding. And their tree roots uptake excess nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus and other pollutants, preventing them from entering into the waterways. Riparian forests also provide important terrestrial habitat for deer, small mammals, birds, and waterfowl. And these streamside forests are especially important for connecting corridors to other larger tracts of forests and habitats. And finally, it is important to highlight the recreation value of Pennsylvania's waterways. Canoeing, kayaking, hunting, fishing, and bird watching are some obvious examples. Pennsylvania's outdoor recreation industry supports 251,000 direct jobs and $29.1 billion in consumer spending and $8.6 billion in wages and salaries. Improved habitat and water quality that result from our forests, especially riparian and streamside forests, only enhance these recreation opportunities. In DCNR, our Bureau of Recreation and Conservation works closely with local governments and other non-government organizations, such as watershed associations, land trusts, recreation commissions, to offer funding and technical assistance related to outdoor recreation and natural resource conservation. The Bureau's Rivers Program focuses on waterways across the Commonwealth. Projects include boat launches, fishing piers, floodplain restoration, small dam removals, stream restoration, fish habitat improvement, and restoring forest buffers. Recent surveys completed for Pennsylvania's Comprehensive Outdoor Recreation Plan noted kayaking as the number one recreation activity that Pennsylvanians want to try. This further supports DCNR's work to improve the close home public access to waterways for recreation. And so for the last segment of my presentation, I'd like to talk about what we're doing to restore forested buffers across the Commonwealth. Planting trees along streams is a relatively simple practice that helps to improve both water quality and habitat. Many of our streams in both rural and urban areas do not have forested buffers. Unfortunately, agencies like the Department of Environmental Protection and organizations like the Stroud Water Research Center started and spearheaded early efforts a few decades ago around planting streams and trees along streams, and now DCNR is picking up this effort, working with our many partners across the Commonwealth. We have a commitment to plant 86,000 acres of forested buffers in the Chesapeake Bay Implementation Plan and about another 10,000 acres in the Ohio and Delaware watersheds. Restoring these forest buffers is one of the most cost-effective and cost-efficient strategies for removing pollutants from the water in working toward our total maximum daily load obligations. However, establishing streamside forests is not without challenges. Ecologically, the challenges include choosing the right trees for the right spaces, overcoming weeds and invasive plants, preventing damage from animals such as white-tailed deer, and planning for proper maintenance to ensure successful planting. And from a social perspective, folks sometimes view these areas as messy or unkept. Farmers need to be compensated for taking land out of crop or pasture production. And it's a change of traditional land uses, which often takes time for folks to adjust. And they cost about $4,000 an acre to install and maintain. So to address these challenges, DCNR has been working with many partners to develop strategies for education, outreach, and implementation. We formed a 50-member advisory committee of experts, and we host an annual conference that usually has over 250 folks attending from across the Commonwealth. Additionally, we've been providing grants to our partners through the Community Conservation Partnership Program, and we've received federal grants and other funding to support direct planting and maintenance of buffers, primarily on agricultural lands, but also in urban areas and backyards and parks, and on institutional properties like schools. So while much of the attention is focused in the Chesapeake Bay and working towards our commitments of the Watershed Implementation Plan, we are engaged statewide with our partners and landowners. DCNR has invested about $5 million over the last 3 years toward planting streamside forests. So in conclusion, I'd like to leave you with a simple message that trees and forests contribute significantly to water quality, habitat, and recreation opportunities, all enhancing our economy and quality of life in the Commonwealth. Additionally, other practices like planting individual trees in communities and conserving existing forests provide these same values. DCNR has many programs and resources available to communities and landowners, including staff, to provide technical assistance and guidance, along with funding for tree planting to enhance our outdoor recreation experiences. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you. Ann?
Thank you very much. Thank you. My name is Ann Swanson. I'm the executive director of the Chesapeake Bay Commission. I'm a trained wildlife biologist and terrestrial ecologist, and I've worked on the Chesapeake Bay for more than 36 years, almost 32 years, as the executive director of the Chesapeake Bay Commission. I want to pause here and tell you that I've probably made more than 1,000 speeches, and what I can tell you is there is nothing, and I want to emphasize nothing, more important than talking to legislators and to General Assembly members. So Chairman Sturla and Mary Jo Daley, I really do appreciate both of you as representatives opening this gate and allowing us to speak, and for all of you here to listen to what we have to say. It's really important, and you hold the decisions. So thank you. So I've given you just a brief slide deck. I want to walk you through some specifics about the commission, some specifics about what's been going on with water quality, and they really end on a very specific note related to legislation, since that is really your decision-making power. First of all, by way of background, just please know that the Chesapeake Bay Commission was created in the 1980s. Pennsylvania joined as a full-fledged member in 1985, making three states, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Virginia. It is a legislative commission. It's the only one like it in a country, and it basically promotes both intrastate and interstate a pollination of ideas. So you have five legislators from each state, in addition to Representative Sturla, who is currently the delegation vice chair and a very long-standing member of the commission. Also, Senator Yaw is currently the delegation chair. Senator Martin, Scott Martin, Representative Garth Everett, Representative Keith Gillespie, and then Secretary Patrick McDonald represents the administration. And rounding out the delegation, there is one citizen member from each state. In the case of Pennsylvania, it's Warren Elliott. So I also want to recognize Morrell King, our Pennsylvania director, who might be a much more familiar voice. To end on that note, let me just say that I personally work for all three states equally, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Virginia, and as you know, have done that for more than three decades. Fortunately, prior speakers have gone over Pennsylvania's role. What I want to tell you is the numbers speak for itself in the slide. They are large in every case, large in terms of land mass, large in terms of water and the amount of water you're delivering to the bay, but also big in terms of the pollutant load. Know that Pennsylvania has the highest stream density of any state in the continental United States. You are water rich, I mean amazingly water rich, but that also means that the pollutant loads are immediately adjacent to those water streams, and that then in turn tumbles downstream. So honestly, what I have to tell you is not only do you have the greatest resource, you have the Achilles heel in that you have the ability to deliver that pollutant load or control it. And really, I'm sorry to say the answer is in your hands in many ways. That doesn't take others off the hook by any means, and I'm going to show you. In terms of the timeline, you've heard people talking about the timeline. Bottom line numbers here. The TMDL, which is that pollution diet, was established in 2010. It does have the force of law. You're supposed to meet your pollution reduction requirements by 2025. That doesn't mean clean water is delivered on that day. What it means is that all the practices and programs are in place to then deliver that, because some of those programs, and as a terrestrial ecologist, I can tell you that if you plant a riparian buffer, it's going to take a number of years before it is at full functionality. But behold, it will be at full functionality, and that's what you're supposed to deliver. The pie charts are the most updated. In fact, in most publications, they aren't even there yet, so please pay attention to the pie charts. Bottom line is while there has been an increase in your developed land and your septics, all of those reductions essentially have been mitigated or eclipsed by your wastewater improvements. So the real challenge here is you really have to get most of your reductions from agriculture. And I think, pay attention to this, it is 34 million pounds, 34 million pounds by 2025. Now, all the states were supposed to achieve 60% of the TMDL by 2017. Pennsylvania achieved 15%. As humans, you probably know, well, what'd the other guys do? And so to let you know, in our case, Virginia achieved 46% of its reduction. 78% of its reduction. Maryland achieved 46% of its reduction. Since 85, Maryland and Virginia have each achieved more than 30 million pounds. So they have done remarkable gains. And here's the thing. We know the best management practices that work. We are victims of our own knowledge in that we know, we have no excuses. And so in that sense, in Pennsylvania, in that same time frame, Pennsylvania achieved 13 million. So 13 million versus 30. So what do we do now? Well, the next three slides really focus on your steps right now and what the challenges are. In terms of agriculture, your watershed implementation calls for 17 million of those pounds to be reduced from agriculture. You need about $187 million annually. The lift is huge. You have to essentially increase by a staggering 67-fold increase. But the other states are not without increased commitments as well. In the case of Virginia, they need to implement a 14-fold increase in agriculture. And in the case of Maryland, they have to ramp up to about 6.5%. Stormwater does provide some opportunities. Stormwater is extremely difficult to control, so I can't emphasize how much, if you don't have to create a stormwater load in your decision-making process, stop it before it's a load, because prevention is the best way. Once you have to control that pollution load, it is extremely expensive. Watershed-wide, the state whips call for about an 82% of the remaining nitrogen reductions to come from agricultural and about 5% from stormwater. And there's more reasons than just the landmass. It's also because of the cost-effective nature of agricultural programs. Forestry, someone already spoke about that, and so you know enough. It means about 5 million pounds. You need about 53 million annually. So what I'm going to do is just spend the last minute or two just really focusing in. So what is the opportunity here? What is the legislative opportunity? Well, your total need is about $521 million, but fortunately you have some of that. So basically you need about $324 million. And that must seem like a staggering amount of money. But remember that almost 20 years ago, six runways at a O'Hare International Airport was $6.7 billion. So big money. Any of you who are appropriators, you know that nowadays money is in millions and millions of dollars. So in this case, we know how to invest it. Now let me talk about this for a minute. First of all, right up front, I have a new dedicated fund. I want to tell you that if you look at those other two states and you look at the 30 million pounds that each one of them captured, there is one reason. And the reason is they have established dedicated funds. In the case of Maryland, for example, they created a household fee, $5. It was called a flush tax. Everybody got all, you know, riled up right in the beginning, but in truth, it went, sailed through quickly because people realized it was $5 that they knew where it was going. They knew it was going to go to clean water, and the end result is all of the major sewage treatment plants in Maryland are now upgraded to world state-of-the-art standards. 40% of the septic users now pay for cover crops, for example. Maryland has an incredible cover crop program, and also in addition, $6 million is dedicated to a Clean Commerce Act, which is very similar to the Procurement Act going through right now in your General Assembly. It's targeted investments, pay for performance. That's how they did it. They also taxed rental cars, for example. And when I'm talking about this, for example, in 5 years, more than billions of dollars have been raised through these revenue streams. For example, in FY19 alone, the rental car fee generated $53 million. In the flush fee, for example, in 2017 was $142 million. Big dollars coming in from small investments. Very small, $5. I pay it, and I'm okay. So the similar in Virginia, there every year they hope there'll be a surplus in terms of the budget. Years ago, members of the commission, again, just like the water fees in Maryland, they carried a piece of legislation designating 10% of the surplus. That surplus, for example, in FY20, it's $73 million. In FY14, it was $106 million. Low point was 17 at $59 million. Even the low point is paying for waste treatment upgrades. It's paying for agricultural best management practices. It's paying for what we know to buy to control clean water. So I've given you this list. back to this slide that says a new dedicated fund, you can see there that in addition to the dedicated fund, I want to tell you there's a fertilizer bill moving right now. Pennsylvania is in its eighth year of considering this bill. All the other states have long passed it. So did New Jersey. Other states called us from elsewhere in the country because you still get your green lawn and you get a pollution reduction. Remember, if you don't put the pollution into the water, it's cheaper. This is just controlling the content of the nitrogen and phosphorus in the bag. And it still triggers green up, and all of our land-grant universities support it. So I really encourage you, pass that. I almost want to say to you, pass that sucker, you know, because it's time. And the second one is that Procurement Act to at least get yourself started down that path. In closing, let me show you the final slide. This is Pennsylvania's impaired waters. Remember I told you about the density? Well, it makes sense that people want to live near the water, and the water will then carry your pollutant load. You have the highest concentration of impaired waters in the continental United States as well, second to Michigan. So there's a reason to pass these kinds of legislation. The people all across the state, not just the Chesapeake Bay watershed, need that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll point out we've also been joined by Representative Mirsky from Erie and Representative Carol Hill Evans from York. Next up, Mr. Gavin.
Morning. Actually, Mr. Chairman, I'll be speaking on behalf of the Commission. My name is Andrew Dyhoff, Executive Director. Joining me is Andrew Gavin. That's okay. It's two Andrews. It's confusing. We have a moratorium on hiring any more Andrews. Andy is joining me as Deputy Executive Director and also head of our technical programs. Appreciate the opportunity to be here. Your packet contains some detailed information on our programs, but in the interest of time, I'll offer a brief summary of those, explain our role in managing Pennsylvania's waters, and offer our perspective on future efforts. First, by way of background, SRBC is a federal interstate compact commission. It was created in 1970 when New York, Pennsylvania, Maryland, and the federal government all adopted equal legislation creating the commission and defining its mission. The laws, collectively referred to as the Susquehanna River Basin Compact, provide broad authorities to the Commission and also emphasize our responsibility to seek partnerships, to fill management gaps, and to promote wise water resource management across state lines. I'm happy to say that over the years, we've worked very closely with Pennsylvania, providing support for our shared interests, such as comprehensive water planning and promoting flood and drought preparedness. Water quantity management, that's quantity, is a strong and in some aspects unique responsibility of the Commission, and a good deal of our focus is there. We are also authorized and do take an active role in supporting water quality management, and I'd like to take just a few minutes today to highlight some of our activities and accomplishments in that arena. As you've heard today and no doubt in other forums, one of the most pressing issues and high profile activities in Pennsylvania right now is the need to reduce nutrient and sediment reductions in Chesapeake Bay. SRBC began conducting monitoring of nutrients and sediment in the river in the 1980s. We also provide trend analyses of those data. In other words, you know, are we seeing progress or slipping, you know, falling back? As you've heard, there has been some positive progress, but there do remain some challenges, and the collaboration will be important to be essential in meeting those goals. More recently, SRBC provided technical assistance to DEP as they developed for EPA their Phase 3 Watershed Implementation Plan, and we appreciated the opportunity to collaborate with our state and local stakeholders, and we're proud of the work we did in development of plans for the pilot counties to begin this effort. Perhaps maybe not grabbing headlines anymore, but nevertheless still important are a few other water quality issues. One is that we're still grappling with legacy issues that have been around for many years, and a prime example is that of mine drainage. There's still many miles of streams in Pennsylvania impaired by mines and mine lands that are no longer operating. Over the years, SRBC has taken a very active role in addressing those impacts to the point of constructing treatment facilities and assisting with reforestation of mine-scarred lands. These efforts are paying off. There are places in the basin where we're now seeing the return of native trout that have not been observed for a century or more. From what I'm hearing, where you're from, there's not a lot of mining maybe in your districts, but there are other issues that will hit home. One that I'd like to talk about is the need to keep our drinking water supplies safe and reliable. SRBC has been an active partner in helping communities to plan and protect to protect their drinking water sources. And we also lead a partnership here in the lower part of the Susquehanna Basin to convene our state and municipal partners to share information on how to address common issues and how to address challenges related to protecting sources of drinking water. A future session of the group will focus on stormwater management as well, which I'm sure you also frequently hear is a growing concern. SRBC does not mandate or enforce stormwater requirements, but our staff does have knowledge and expertise with management techniques, and we aim in the future to be a resource to help communities meet their requirements. So with all these pressing needs that I've articulated and others have as well, how do you know what to pursue? As you consider how to prioritize these various issues, I think it's worth noting the integrated nature of water resources. Simply put, surface water and groundwater are inextricably linked. Water quantity and water quality are likewise intertwined. Maybe that sounds like it complicates matters, but it's actually a good thing. It promotes and presents some opportunities. It means if you're smart about it, you can often address multiple objectives when you plan water resource management projects. For example, if you plan and construct stormwater management infrastructures to meet some of those requirements, if you do it in ways that can also help meet Chesapeake Bay restoration goals, can also reduce hazardous flash flooding, or could add security to the safety and reliability of our drinking water supplies. The Commission has the capacity, and I think it's entirely consistent with our charter, to help Pennsylvania identify high priority efforts and to collectively target new resources and effectively move them towards forging partnerships to maximize benefits. I'd like to close by suggesting a viewpoint that you may find useful in speaking with your constituents and your colleagues when working to address our water challenges. When we're discussing the dedication of resources to water resources management, planning, conservation, and protection, I think we should steer the conversation not to it being a burden or to being done just to merely meet regulatory requirements, but rather that it's an investment and one that pays dividends. Not only do healthy watersheds promote and support economic development, tourism, and recreation, but when our watersheds are healthy, our drinking water supplies are more drought resilient. When our watersheds are healthy, there's less need for stormwater management. And when our watersheds are healthy, the frequency and severity of flood damages are often reduced. Relatively low-cost measures to keep our waterways healthy can minimize or eliminate high-cost crises down the road. Investing in sound water resource management is truly an excellent example of an ounce of prevention being worth a pound of cure. This concludes my remarks. On behalf of the SRBC commissioners, we appreciate the time afforded us to address the policy committee, and thank you for providing this forum for discussion of Pennsylvania's vital water resources.
Thank you. Mr. Nerozzi?
Good morning, Chairman Sturla, Representative Daley, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to participate in today's hearing. As a Commonwealth Natural Resource Agency with a mission to protect, conserve, and enhance Pennsylvania's aquatic resources and provide fishing and boating opportunities, the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission has an important role in keeping the Commonwealth's waters clean, both for the health of aquatic species and the enjoyment of our nearly 3 million anglers and boaters. Here in Pennsylvania, we are fortunate to have an abundance of water resources, including over 99,000 acres of lakes and over 85,000 miles of rivers and streams, which is second only to the state of Alaska. But to whom much is given, much is expected, and that is why Commission staff are hard at work every day to ensure the quality of our waterways is conserved for future generations. To describe the entirety of the Commission's work in this area would take far longer than the time we have available this morning, but I would like to provide a brief overview of the programs and initiatives that we feel have had the greatest impact on water quality. Perhaps most notably, the Commission has a cooperative role in developing the Department of Environmental Protection's Chapter 93 Water Quality Standards, which safeguard streams, rivers, and lakes from human impacts. Each year, our fisheries biologists conduct hundreds of surveys on streams throughout the Commonwealth to document the presence of wild trout, which are important indicator species for water quality. Depending on the biomass present, a stream may be eligible to receive upgraded protections from wastewater discharges and other sources of pollution. In total, over 16,000 miles of stream are managed for wild trout in Pennsylvania, and less than 16% are designated as Class A wild trout streams. These prized waters are eligible for a high-quality designation under Chapter 93, which helps ensure these productive waters are protected for the future. The amount of time and resources that go into surveying for wild trout is considerable, and as many of you know, the Commission is a relatively small agency. It is important then to acknowledge the valuable contributions of our partner organizations through the Unassessed Waters Initiative. Under this program, colleges and universities, research entities, and conservation organizations examine waters that have not been previously inventoried for wild trout. These organizations use the commission sampling protocols and work in high-priority watersheds. In recent years, roughly 850 waters have been surveyed annually under this program. Our work on behalf of water resources, however, goes well beyond wild trout programs. The Commission's Division of Environmental Services works proactively with expert scientists and engineers from a variety of disciplines to ensure that all aquatic life, including threatened and endangered species, remain protected. Our staff review thousands of permit applications every year for many program areas that include transportation, mining, natural gas, and aquatic pesticide use. We review state and federal laws and regulations that could have an impact on jurisdictional species and routinely comment on water quality, habitat, and in-stream flow protection issues. In addition, the Commission's network of nearly 100 waterways conservation officers, commonly known as referred to as WCOs, respond to pollution and habitat disturbances throughout the Commonwealth. Our officers have conducted field investigations on over 1,500 suspected water pollution incidents since 2011. I'm happy to report that a class of 27 cadets are currently going through the year-long training process and will be in the field across Pennsylvania next summer, allowing us to serve anglers and boaters in your districts better than we have been able to for many years. The Commission has adapted to our changing economy and domestic energy portfolio. In 2012, as Pennsylvania was experiencing a rapid expansion of natural gas production and a large influx of permitted activities, the General Assembly saw the value in proactively working to avoid conflicts with aquatic resources and directed $1 million annually from Act 13 to our agency for costs associated with natural gas permit reviews. The Commission developed a dedicated team of biologists to assist DEP and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers with activities related to unconventional drilling in and around waterways and wetlands. This includes reviewing and commenting on the construction of access roads, pipelines, well pads, water withdrawals, and other infrastructure projects to ensure minimal impact to aquatic life. This program has proven highly successful and has led to cooperative relationships with both industry representatives and our partner state agencies. The last 10 years has brought a renewed focus on the health of the Chesapeake Bay watershed, and more specifically, the health of the Susquehanna River. The Commission has taken a prominent role in this process by conducting cost-effective habitat work throughout the watershed, including stream bank stabilization, the restoration of riparian corridors, and the removal of obsolete dams to help return waterways to their natural free-flowing state. We've worked with local farmers to install streamside fencing, livestock crossings, and other inexpensive best management practices that benefit downstream ecosystems, as well as recreational users that rely on clean water. In fact, the Commission is currently working with the EPA and DEP to nearly triple the size of our stream habitat section so we can continue assisting the Commonwealth in meeting these TMDL requirements within the watershed. Finally, I'd like to stress that clean water doesn't just benefit the environment and public health. It also benefits our economy. According to a study conducted last year by the Theodore Roosevelt Conservation Partnership, anglers contribute nearly $1.2 billion to the Pennsylvania economy, both through consumer spending and the 7,000 jobs that are supported by fishing. These contributions are predicated on abundant populations of trout, bass, walleye, and other popular game species which rely on clean water. In a separate poll, TRCP found that 76% of sportsmen believe rivers and streams are, quote, essential to the local economy. These figures further illustrate the importance of conserving, protecting, and enhancing the aquatic resources we have been entrusted with here in Pennsylvania. Thank you for providing me with this opportunity to testify, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thanks. Thank you all. We're only running about 10 minutes behind time. Now comes the tough part. Let's see when we start asking questions how far. questions from members. Representative Webster.
I have kind of a quick question for Matthew. It's not controversial in any way, but it went through my head as you were talking about 70% of our forested lands are privately owned. Do you see that those are developable properties over time? Are they mostly, you know, up and down vertical slopes? And I mean, I know that some of them are just beautiful, pristine properties that people want to own, but how much of that is, you know, even usable so that we know they're comfortable being forests for a long time?
Yeah.
Sure. I'm not sure if I have any statistics, but in the northern parts of the state and even not far from here, either to the west or directly north, the sides of the mountains are very steep and rocky and typically would not be suitable for development. It's mostly driven by, you know, the conditions on the ground, whether it's too rocky or steep or wet. But I think a lot of folks that own the properties have a stewardship ethic and they want to keep their lands forested and to continue to provide those values. So it's a mix of, I think, the social considerations, the ecological considerations, and the economy.
I have a question for Ann and the Andrews. I live in the Delaware River watershed, and we recently, in fact, Representative Webster was with me, were at the Delaware River Basin Commission, and one of the concerns they expressed was with climate change and the rising ocean levels, there is a threat of the salinity line rising, which would affect drinking water supplies, particularly in Philadelphia. And I was wondering if the Chesapeake Bay and the Susquehanna, are they facing any sort of challenges along those lines having to do with our rising ocean levels?
You want to start from the bays? Perspective. So our jurisdiction ends at a railroad bridge just north of where the just upstream where the river enters into the bay, and there's a large concrete structure called Conowingo Dam near there that prevents it is tidal at that point, but really prevents salinity from intruding too far into the river. There is, however, at least one water supply intake below the dam that does have to be conscious of salinity levels in the river, particularly during drought times. And when you talk about climate change and just overall water management, although there is a dam there that does somewhat regulate the flow, it is important that we consider, again, quantity and quality and ensuring that there is adequate flow going down the river during times of drought that can keep that salinity salt front at bay. But it's not as drastic an issue as in the Delaware. But.
Thanks. I'll point out we've been joined by Representative Steve McCarter from Montgomery County also. I have a couple questions. Oh, Representative Mirsky, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question for Matthew. I don't know if this is uniquely in western Pennsylvania, but there seems to be, regarding the trees and the watershed, PennDOT has been cutting down a lot of trees along both in urban areas and in rural areas, citing it's not safe because cars will go off the road and crash. However, these are in the Lake Erie watershed, many of that, and we all know that the waters of Lake Erie is where all of northwest Pennsylvania, especially Erie County, most of Erie County receives their water. Just more of a comment than a question. If we could work together with the two agencies, I think that restoring those trees is important, and not only for the watershed, but also the environment in as a whole. And my just another question, and I don't know anyone on the panel can answer it. In terms of water quality, we talk about the water in Lake Erie, especially. We've had a lot of issues with invasive species. If anyone would just touch on that briefly.
Well, I can certainly discuss it, invasive species. I mean, in both the Chesapeake and obviously Lake Erie, but it's really a world phenomenon. We really need to do as good a job as we can from stopping the transport of organisms from one system to another, because they can often get in another system, but then they don't have the adequate predators, essentially, to keep them under control. So in the Chesapeake region, we now have sort of a changing species regime going on, because, for example, with these large blue cats, for example, we have significant numbers of them now that are displacing native species. We have invasive crabs. We have invasive small fish and also a variety of even seagrass species. So it's very, very common that this occurs. How it's going to affect water quality is an interesting one, because that tends to be related to the filter feeders. And so in the case of Lake Erie, of course, they've had a lot of experience with zebra mussel. And it's funny, you know, you can have waters that are like too clean because essentially they're being overly filtered by a species. So it is an ongoing balance and something we really keep our eyes on. Yeah.
Representative Daley.
Thank you. I have a bill in the House, House Bill 1475, that would create a inventory of conservation corridors or wildlife corridors in Pennsylvania, because what we found is that they are overseen by a lot of different agencies and departments and even private property in some of them. And I was actually really pleased to hear a few of you in your testimony make a reference to that idea. So, but I'm just interested, does anyone want to comment that it's important for us to know where they are and who's controlling them and what kind of shape they're in before we can make a determination on how to take care of them. So I just wanted to have a copy of the bill if anyone wants a copy of it, and would appreciate your feedback. We did consult with DCNR and Fish and Boat before doing that, but I think it's a small piece. But the other thing, Anne, I wanted to just thank you for giving us kind of a really good list of things. My two colleagues who unfortunately had to leave are both on the Finance Committee, and we've been spending a fair amount of time over the summer and continuing it talking about, we call it the tax study group. What you were talking about actually I think is really interesting, and I'm going to chat with them afterwards, but it'd be, so it sounds like Maryland and Virginia are doing some good things that we should really start to talk. Has Pennsylvania ever had a water fund?
Never.
Okay.
I want to say that again. Never. And because it's so important. And again, there is this evidence we can get. We can provide you literally evidence that shows once it was established what happened. The other thing is, for example, at the federal level, we worked on a thing called the Chesapeake Watershed Initiative. That watershed initiative brought an additional $52 million annually into this region for 6 years. If we were to show you the charts, which we're happy to show you a graph, essentially what you see is a rise in agricultural implementation. When that money then stopped because the 2014 Farm Bill, the rest of the nation wanted what we had, so then they essentially diluted the program to be nationwide, implementation of ag practices across the watershed fell by half. What that tells me is it proves that if you have the money, but also the technical assistance, earlier on, when I said you need $324 million, $24 million of those dollars are for people to deliver the programs. And people make the difference. So I would really emphasize that those dedicated programs really do deliver. And I'm very happy to provide you with the information, Morell and I, about exactly what happened in each of the states. The other thing is, each one of those programs, because they were moved at the right time, there was actually not an enormous amount of controversy. And you would have thought that billing people every month would have been. But what it was is it was rolled out as a very methodical process that was going to be then tightly controlled. You know, we knew how it would be invested. So, and let me just say one other thing about your bill. If you don't know what you're trying to protect, how do you protect it? So I think you're doing an incredibly smart thing. The other thing is I would tell you that right now there is data sets available to us right now that instead of 900 meters square, the data sets available to the states through the Chesapeake Bay program are at 1 meter squared. So not only do you understand at 1 meter, you know, 1 meter, you can't fit a tree in 1 meter. And so essentially you have this enormous detail, and you can even understand the slopes there. So you can answer the other gentleman's question about what percent of the forest might be kind of naturally protected. But regardless of whether they're protected from development, they need to be protected for the warblers. They need to be protected for the water. They need to be protected for the other, let alone just peace of mind. So I just will definitely take a look at your bill.
Great, thanks.
Representative Anna Murata.
Hi, thank you all for testifying. Many of you mentioned that your current role is dealing with legacy issues because we didn't have the proper, maybe we didn't have the proper information or the proper regulations in place to be able to handle that industry at that given time when it was operating. And, you know, Ms. Atkinson, you've mentioned that many of the problems are, you know, still ahead of us. And so when I think about Pennsylvania as an energy producer, especially in the conventional and unconventional oil and gas drilling, I'm thinking about the amount of waste that we're producing, 69 million barrels of liquid waste, 1.4 million tons of solid waste in 2018. So I expect that to be similar year after year. So I'm hoping to have some folks speak on how we're managing that, especially because of the materials that are used for the extraction of fracked gas and natural gas, as well as the radioactive materials that are extracted and contained in the biosolids during that process, and how we're making sure that our waterways are protected in that waste management process.
I'll start. SRBC's role is very limited to water use, but something we did early on to get to your last point about waterways being protected was implement a monitoring network in streams where fracking was occurring to verify what the producers were telling everybody, which is that we can do this safely. It's like, okay, well, you know, let's monitor the streams and see. So our network was set up to monitor water quality in areas where fracking was occurring and not occurring, or perhaps will be occurring down the road. So we also had a baseline of what were natural conditions before the activity began. It was designed to capture parameters that you'd expect to see if there was some sort of impact from the activity, and also set up so that it's reported automatically to our website so that in real time, essentially, every you know, periodic uploads automatically so that the public can see and track, you know, whether there are things happening. So I think that's been successful. We've assessed the data and can't identify any specific long-term impacts that you wouldn't expect to see with land development, but the monitoring system does remain in place. It can help detect some sort of accident or spill early on. We haven't, you know, seen much of that, but again, sort of a limited aspect to your question because we don't oversee any waste or anything like that. But to your point of it's an important something that wasn't done in the past with coal mining and other other activities that we're still suffering from.
I'll just contribute. There is oil and gas development on state forest in north central PA. We have a comprehensive set of guidelines that we and at least structure that we work with the companies to manage the on-the-ground conditions. We partner with SRBC with that monitoring program, both aquatic systems and terrestrially. And we have reports that we publish periodically, and we would be happy to share those with you.
Similarly, the waste side of the house isn't in my purview, but in the water quality realm, we do have a water quality network that's statewide that allows us to observe impacts of contaminants in the waste in the water stream, and if there is any issues, that is usually alerted to us through that process. As I mentioned in my testimony, we do permitting, and in some cases we have to identify limits on what can be discharged, so based on what we know is not harmful. And that also allows us to do an evaluation of the waters. If there's a change that needs to happen when we're going back and looking at our monitoring systems and see, hey, something's not working, that allows us to adjust our permitting system so that we can ramp down any contaminants or emerging contaminants that we might see coming along. We also partner with SRBC in some of those efforts while we look at water quality. If you want more information on waste, I can definitely put you in contact with my counterparts.
Yeah, that would be great. Do you guys test for radioactivity or radioactive matter?
top of my head, I cannot give you the list, but I can provide that to you at a later date of all the
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I just want to emphasize something. At the end of the day, you have all these tools. You have programmatic tools. You have modeling tools. But it is the monitoring that actually speaks the truth at the end of the day. So it basically measures your ultimate success, your ultimate prevention. And so as legislators, I would really encourage you, as you are obviously doing, Representative, to keep your eye on the funding streams that are essentially supporting government monitoring programs. Because again, I see them, I know in the Chesapeake Bay, and the whole watershed effort, those monitoring programs are what hold us accountable.
Thanks. I just want to point out either I or Representative Everett or the both of us will be reintroducing a dedicated water fund bill this year, which charges a hundredth of a cent per gallon for the waters that we know are already taken out of the waterways of Pennsylvania. Anybody that takes more than 10,000 gallons a day has to register with the state, and they get a permit, and then we let them for free take 10,000 or more gallons a day. If we just charge them a hundredth of a cent per gallon, we can generate about $375 million a year.
I'll sign on to that.
Because there's like 9 billion gallons a day taken out of the way. And that's without charging municipal water systems or agriculture, because I don't want to go there. That would help us with Alcosan in the Ohio watershed, would help us with the Chesapeake Bay in the Susquehanna watershed, would help us with stormwater issues in the Delaware River Basin, would help us up in Erie, across the state it would help us. So I will also say that there is something as simple as right now, in the state of Pennsylvania, there is a prohibition against local governments mandating that you have to keep your cows out of the stream. There's a prohibition against allowing local municipalities to say, keep your cows out of the stream. That to me is just unreal. Because when you talk to large animal vets, they say a cow in a stream means you're going to have much more disease with that animal. And we can't even, it's against the law to pass a law to keep the cows out of the stream. That's just nuts. So we've got a long way to go there.
And we would also like people to be able to get
in the stream. Yes.
Clean,
right.
Sanitary conditions.
Yeah. Yeah. So having talked about the amount of money we need, Ms. Atkinson, in your testimony, you said an important part of ensuring progress in implementing Pennsylvania's Phase 3 Chesapeake Bay WIP is an investment of, and you said, significant resources. In your testimony, it was written as sufficient resources. I'm not upset with you that we only provide significant resources, because albeit woefully inefficient or insufficient funds, how your department's only going to spend what we give you. How can we convince our colleagues that even though you're spending a significant amount of money, it's woefully insufficient?
One of the things that I'm working on to right now is staffing up my program. And one of the things that I keep running into, and I think this kind of brings everything together, is finding the best candidates. They're very qualified. And then I offer them the package that the Commonwealth allows me to. And I'm a go-getter. I usually ask for approval for the top, and then everyone laughs at me. Great. So I think that kind of is it in a nutshell as an agency. I don't think we're current in our understanding of how much these practices cost, how much the technical expertise costs to make sure that they're implemented and maintained. We're used to a very antiquated system, and I think a lot more needs to be done in our understanding of the rest of the world. I have been working with my staff. I mean, I talked about the integrated water quality monitor and assessment report that we made interactive, letting people know what we do and the effort behind doing that. Like, that took funding, that took IT funds, that took a huge amount of staff time. That meant I didn't have guys out doing in the streams because they were in there working to get this system together so that the layperson can go in and say, well, how's the stream looking in my backyard? And should I have concerns or should I not have concerns? But all that costs money. So that's what I think about every day, is that I try to impart upon people. You know, we talk about money all the time. We hear it in the news and we know what it is. But for some reason, when we get into our four corners, we seem to think that there's this reduced fee for us, and it's not.
Okay. One final question that I want to throw out there, Ann pointed out that we now have LiDAR images down to every square meter. So in theory, someone somewhere should be able to pull up a map that says, here's this room, and here's the slope of the land, here's whether there's water on it, here's whether there's vegetation on it, here's the composition of the soil. Mm-hmm. And if I can do that and make that information available to every conservation district, every river basin commission, every group that's planting trees, I have this pet peeve. I know we're never going to be able to plant enough stream banks. And so I know that if I plant on the north side of a stream, the shade from the tree is going to shade the farmer's crops, and it's not going to reduce the temperature in the stream. If I plant on the south side of the stream, the shade is only going to fall on the stream, not on the farmer's crops, and it's going to reduce the temperature in the stream. But that information is not available to the average person that's got the stream running through their property to say, if you'll just plant a tree for us in the appropriate place, we'll get twice or three times or 10 times the impact than if you just plant a tree. And all we're doing is asking them to just plant a tree. How can we get that level of information, that level of detailed information, to every property owner in the state of Pennsylvania? Because I think there's a whole lot of people that would voluntarily go out there and do everything they could, talk to their neighbors, and, you know, but they're not equipped with that information. It's like we're withholding it from them. Yeah?
Yeah, so the good news is we are working on just those types of programs and protocols. A challenge is that the data sets are very, very large, and it takes a lot of time just to sort of to calculate the data and put it in a form that's accessible. Our goals for riparian buffers were based on that data, where we looked at what we call the buffer gaps, so where there's a gap in the forest along streams. So we have those data, we're using them. We have a partner named the Chesapeake Conservancy. They're based in Annapolis, but they're working in Pennsylvania and Center and Clinton counties. They've developed reports almost identical to what you're describing, where it's a map of a farmer or a landowner's property, shows the stream, and it calculates the benefit of installing a riparian buffer based on the attributes of the land, whether it's pasture or crop and other habitat values. And so we're working with a marketing firm in DCNR to help spread that word and really try to understand what are the drivers. So what are important to people, whether it's economy or a job or clean water or something in their backyard, to help us make that connection. What we've found in public polling is that water quality is not a driver. People just don't think about it or make the connection. And so we're really trying to focus on what's important to people and then make the connection. So we're working on it. We'll be happy to share those projects. I don't want to sound like a bureaucrat, but it's taking a while to get off the ground. But thank you for the
It's a great comments. Question, and yeah. You articulated a problem. How do you get it out there? The commission has taken advantage of, like we always try to do with technology, how can we make this useful? In Chickies Creek watershed in Lancaster County, we've used that type of information to develop what we call flow paths. It does look at the surface. And essentially tells you where you're likely to see runoff when it does rain. That way you can target, it's a little different from stream buffers, but you can target your BMP activity to areas that will be the most beneficial. So we've worked with the counties and conservation groups to make that a web-based type application so that those who are interested in the information don't have to deal with the voluminous data and are able to use it.
In my testimony, I talked about the Commission's responsibility to protect aquatic threatened and endangered species and then even broader species of greatest conservation need. So we have 664 of these species in Pennsylvania alone. And so one of the things that we're doing to, again, sort of personalize that experience is we're creating an online portal together with the Pennsylvania Game Commission, who we manage what's called a state wildlife action plan. They're required by the federal government through the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. So we're creating an online portal that sort of takes that plan and puts it online that someone can go on, essentially search for their property, comes up, shows what species of greatest conservation need are present, and then gives proactive tips and conservation habitat work that they can do on their property to not only benefit those species, but then inherently the water quality as well that they survive in.
Yeah, so
I'm also thinking that, like, you've just talked about some things that I think as state legislators, we have town halls, we get community people together. And I feel like if we had some of this information to share, it'd be really helpful to us too, because you might be able to find people who make that connection between water quality and, oh, like, I really do care about that. And we all have clean water coming out of the tap. I mean, why should we worry about something that is so inexpensive and so readily available? But I'm so grateful for all these things you're talking about. But I feel like we have another panel.
So maybe the closing point that I was going to make there is that if you pay for this type of analysis, and it does exist, and you target that analysis to the places where you know have the greatest impact to your waters, don't forget to fund sufficient technical assistance, because it's the technical assistance piece, it's those people who are going to say, wow, in this particular county, we have three legislators who are doing public forums. We have two soil conservation districts, and we can get the information out through them. They're going to figure out how to get the information out, and they're also going to be the trustable voices within that community. And so with anything that you move, make sure that your water fund or whatever is funding the kind of analysis you're talking about, but also the delivery of it, or else it doesn't work. So thank you.
Sure. Yeah.
Getting the message out, I'm, engineer by background, but I went to a liberal arts school to get my degree, surprisingly. But we're scientists. We don't usually speak my neighbor's language, right? If I go out and say, don't direct your thing to the gutter, and I start talking about velocity and rate, my neighbor looks at me like I'm crazy. If I say, don't do this because your car is going to flood out tomorrow, then she moves it. So there is a language barrier that we need to overcome. And DEP, we're working really hard to do that. I mean, some of these agencies, even ourselves, have, contracted with, Waterworks and different agencies that kind of talk to people. But one model that I've seen in state government that I've been surprised at the result is the spotted lanternfly. Have you seen how? And I was the DEP's representative in getting that out to our. But everyone knows about that spotted lanternfly. So whatever campaign that they've been doing, I know it has a lot to do with wine and beer because that's what I use, but that has been a very effective campaign on informing citizens of the issue.
We've been hosting town halls about spotted lanternfly and what you do about it. And I'm telling you, I was sitting at the train station in my hometown waiting for a train, and people saw spotted lanternflies, and there were multiple people jumping up at the train station to step and squish them. And there's an app that you can take a picture of the squished or spotted lanternfly and report it in, and I'm telling you,
report it dead.
It's I have the app on my phone.
All right, thank you very much. This has been very informative. Because we're running 20 minutes behind, we're going to just skip. No, I'm. We're going to bring the next two panels up together. So Jacqueline Bonomo, President and CEO of Penn Future, John Stoltz, Director of the Center for Environmental Research and Education at Duquesne University, Russ Collins, Vice President of the South Central Region, Trout Unlimited, and John Kenny, former member USA Swimming National Open Water Team.
So I realize that you probably all saw a lot of reps getting up and leaving, and I heard them having committee meetings. I can't tell you how much I appreciate your being here and looking forward to your testimony, because I think actually you are all in the kinds of areas where you can help spread the word about some of the things that we just heard that we need to spread the word about. But we'll get started, and thank you all. So Jackie, do you want to start?
Sure, certainly. So, Representative Daley and Chairman Sturla, members, thanks so very much for the opportunity to be here. I'm Jackie Bonomo, President and CEO of Penn Future, a statewide environmental advocacy organization that currently represents more than 60,000 members and supporters. We strongly support adequate funding for our agencies tasked with environmental protection, responsible enforcement of environmental laws, and the advancement of new policies that protect public health and natural resources in the Commonwealth. There is a water crisis, a clean water crisis here. Pennsylvania has long held the position of being home to some of the most beautiful creeks, streams, and rivers in the country, but the Commonwealth has an equally long history of environmental degradation and water quality challenges. The need for protection and restoration of Pennsylvania's waters is not a challenge unique to any one watershed or basin. Every corner of the state and the four watersheds that encompass us are affected by dirty water. On a regular basis, the Great Lakes Basin has to deal with harmful algal blooms, which are largely caused by agricultural runoff. A significant part of Pennsylvania's 70-plus mile Lake Erie shoreline is dominated by grape growing. And while our portion of Lake Erie has been relatively lucky when compared to other parts of the Lake Erie Basin, vigilance is necessary here. The waters of the Ohio River Basin have been heavily contaminated by legacy industries such as coal, oil, and steel. The Ohio Basin, and indeed the rest of the state, now face emerging threats from the gas and petrochemical industries. The ultimate environmental and human tolls of these industries will be unknown for generations, but they will come. We've heard a lot about the Chesapeake Bay watershed, which includes the Susquehanna and Potomac basins, and that Pennsylvania is poised to miss its EPA Phase 3 watershed implementation goals for 2025 for the reduction of phosphorus nitrogen sedimentation, which is caused predominantly by non-point source agriculture and water pollution. Penn Future has expressed concerns about these shortfalls, but we also recommend the WIP in its current iteration moving quickly toward implementation, but that will, of course, not be possible until the state comes to grips with the $324 million we need to implement it. The headwaters region of the Delaware River boasts some of the Commonwealth's cleanest streams, headwater streams that are designated as high quality and exceptional value streams. Overdevelopment and impact from growth in the Poconos threatens to fundamentally change this region, its forests and waters, and economic livelihoods derived from it. And while we appreciate SRBC's work on mine drainage, let's not forget Nescopeck Creek, a major drainage to the Susquehanna. The Nescopeck Creek receives the largest acid mine drainage on the east coast of the United States. That drainage has not been dealt with, and the time has come for that to change. Clean water in Pennsylvania can underpin further economic development and growth here for industries like food processing and sustainable agriculture and beverage bottling, but only if it is abundant and available. Through insufficient funding, lax regulation, and undue industry influence, we're putting that economic development at risk. Secretary Atkinson mentioned the 2018 Integrated Water Quality Report that was recently published. What's astonishing is that the most recent report reveals that now nearly 43% of Pennsylvania's waterways are impaired. Pennsylvanians rely on this water for drinking, recreation, yet more than 37,000 miles are impaired, almost half of our 85,000 miles of free-flowing streams and rivers. This is not acceptable, and real investment and attention from the legislature can go a long way in addressing this problem. We need our state executive branch, agencies, and the General Assembly to take this seriously. Best management practices can transform local impaired waterways. Funding for conservation projects makes a real tangible difference in the quality of Pennsylvania's waters. Implementation of best management practices such as planting forested riparian buffers, installing stream bank fencing, retrofitting impervious surfaces, modernizing barnyards, and increasing green stormwater infrastructure makes a significant impact on the quality of our water and can accrue positive benefits to our state's number one and number two industries being agriculture and tourism. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip over the several examples of best management success stories that are included in my written testimony. But these investments are economically efficient and accruing real benefits in terms of water quality, especially as it addresses impacts from agriculture and stormwater. There are opportunities for the legislature. Keeping clean water clean and investing in restoration of impaired waters makes economic sense for our state. But in recent years, these investments have fallen off dramatically, and benefits made from Growing Greener 1 and Growing Greener 2 are far off in our rearview mirrors. We urge the General Assembly to pass legislation that provides adequate funding for state resource agencies and commissions, establishes a dedicated fund for watershed restoration with reliable fixed funding mechanisms, as we've heard before, funding that restores full share funding to Pennsylvania's interstate basin commissions, funding that will empower all classes of municipalities to reduce the impacts of stormwater runoff by providing technical assistance and strengthening stormwater management programs. Pass the fertilizer bill that will set standards and training expectations for fertilizer applications and renew the Growing Greener program. Further, the legislature must guard against legislative attempts to undermine water protection enforcement and regulation that are ever present, including Senate Bill 619, which would rewrite the state's clean streams laws, House Bill 1635, which would roll back clean water regulations for conventional oil and gas drilling industry, and fight hard against Energize Pennsylvania, a package of bills that in essence subsidizes the oil, gas, and petrochemical industries to grow their plastics production in Pennsylvania. As Representative Daley referenced in her opening, on May 18, 1971, Pennsylvania voters passed by a margin of 4-1 what is now Article 1, Section 27 of our state's Constitution, the Environmental Rights Amendment. Penn Future wholeheartedly agrees with Pennsylvania's Environmental Rights Amendment and its supposition that all Pennsylvanians, no matter what place, station, agency, or background, have a right to clean water. We stand ready and are eager to help the General Assembly advance clean water legislation, solve the funding shortages, and move forward clean water funding and fight back against dangerous attempts to weaken our precious resources. Thank you for your time, and please continue to use Penn Future as a resource for your work.
Hi. I'd first like to thank Chairman Sturla and Representative Daley for having this hearing, and Sarah Amorato, who's a representative from my neck of the woods. I'm John Stoltz. I'm a professor and director of the Center of Environmental Research and Education at Duquesne University. I live in Glenshaw, which is North Pittsburgh, and I'm going to kind of cut things down because I did provide you with some testimony, but for the sake of time, I've been studying environmental microbiology for 40 years plus and specifying in water quality issues. Since late 2009, my students and I have studied the impact of unconventional oil and gas extraction, specifically with an emphasis on water quality, both surface and groundwater. The good news is we still have extraordinary high-quality water resources in Pennsylvania. The bad news is that they continue to face threats from oil and gas extraction and the development of the emerging petrochemical industry. So over the past last 8 years, my students and I have interviewed hundreds of Pennsylvanians with private water well and collected over and analyzed 1,100 samples. We've also conducted file reviews at the DEP of permits, completion reports to assemble detailed maps of oil and gas activities in these areas. And I'm just gonna summarize a few things that we found. I'll start with the complaints, because as far as that's concerned, I always think, what does this impact have on people? And so I think the complaints to the DEP really give you an indication. So I work with Public Herald, which is a nonprofit media outlet. I'm their science advisor. But we discovered that between 2004 and 2016, there were 9,442 complaints filed to the PEDEP Gas and Oil Office. Of these, it was determined that over 4,100 were water-related. My group did a follow-up and found that even between 2017 and 2018, there were an additional 1,397 complaints. So basically, to summarize, there have been 11,767 unconventional wells drilled in Pennsylvania since 2004. And since that time, there have been 10,839 complaints, over which 40% are related to water issues. Investigation into specific complaints revealed that the DEP has been using sweet codes to limit the amount of information in the water test results provided to the homeowners. It also revealed that detection limits that the DEP is using for certain tests are higher than those reported for the U.S. EPA methodology. The result is that key constituents related to oil and gas contamination, such as bromide, have been reported as BDL or below detection limits. In other instances where toxic compounds have been detected, no action has been taken if they are below the EPA's maximum contaminant levels. Lastly, we found that 54% of the water complaints were resolved within, only 54% were resolved within the legally required time limits. So basically, there's some issues there in which they're not using enough sensitive tests, if you will, or at least reporting and taking care of these complaints within the allotted time. So now I'll give you a specific example that I've worked with. The Woodlands is a community of about 200 families in Butler County, north of Pittsburgh. There have been 32 unconventional Marcellus wells on 12 pads drilled between 2009 and 2012 that surround the community. I was contacted by a homeowner late summer of 2011 to test their well. My group subsequently interviewed 143 households, and 56, or 39% of them, indicated that their water quality or quantity had changed since the drilling began. Because of the varying depths of the water wells, between 65 and 900 feet, there was no discernible pattern of contamination. But of the 33 homes we tested, 25 had levels of manganese above EPA secondary standards for drinking water, and we were able to obtain pre-drilled data for several homes to establish that their water quality had indeed changed. The study was published in 2015, so it's peer-reviewed. 10 families subsequently sued the drilling company in 2013, and this past year they settled for $159,000. Today, 50 families in this community still rely on a volunteer water drive by the local church. Injection wells. My group has conducted a water well survey in Grant Township, Indiana County. This was done in anticipation of a permitted injection well facility. I discovered that well water testing is not required prior to the onset of operations of an injection well. Thanks to the great community engagement, we were able to sample 39 private wells, 15 of which were within 1 mile of the proposed injection well. Our results indicate that in general the wells are potable and high quality at that. It is beyond my comprehension as to why the DEP has taken legal steps to force this township to allow the injection well, as they have no access to public water. And lastly, the one that I think is most pressing at this point, the improper disposal of oil and gas waste, both solid and liquid, continues to pose a threat to public drinking water sources. So we're talking public now, not private well water. The practice of allowing publicly owned sewage treatment plants known as POTWs was prohibited in 2012 after it was discovered that it was impacting the discharge from these plants into public waters. The increase in total dissolved solids, and bromine in particular, was causing problems for public drinking water authorities. Carcinogenic trihalomethanes were being generated during the chlorination process. The prohibition initially led to a decrease in bromide levels in the three levels of rivers, but this problem has reemerged over the last few years. I've discovered that the PADEP allows drilling waste, both solid and liquid, to be taken to sanitary landfills, up to 80% volume per day. The solids, such as drill cuttings, are buried along with the miscible waste and used as cover. The liquids, which may contain drilling fluids, flow back, and produce water, are quote unquote immobilized and buried along with the municipal waste. This past April, I met with the manager of the POTW in Bell Vernon. They had been receiving leachate from the Ross River landfill from 100,000 to 300,000 gallons a day. The leachate was so toxic it killed the microbial population that was supposed to treat the sewage. My analysis of the leachate showed that it was similar composition to fracking waste, having high chloride and bromide levels, as well as radioactive radium. The discharge from the PODW, which I collected at the time, also had similar constituents, including bromide and radium, although more dilute. This discharge exceeded the permitted amount of total dissolved solids by almost three times and was going directly into the Monongahela River. The Charleroi drinking water facility is just a mile or so downstream. So it wasn't surprising to discover that they have been having issues with trihalomethane since at least 2015. Thanks to a court injunction, the PODW is no longer receiving leachate from the landfill and are now back in compliance for their discharge. I confirmed this when I visited the plant back in the end of May. There are at least 16 sanitary landfills in Pennsylvania that are reporting to be taking oil and gas waste. It's clear to me that this practice is affecting the quality of the leachate, rendering it more toxic and radioactive. Further allowing this leachate to be disposed of at POTWs threatens these operations of these facilities and is facilitating the discharge of oil and gas waste in the waters of Pennsylvania. I therefore encourage you to support the legislation as proposed by Representative Anamorato. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman and Co-Chair Daley and Representative Anamorato. My name is Russ Collins, and I have served as Vice President for chapter of Trout Unlimited here in Central Pennsylvania and Dauphin and Lemon counties, and am now serving my second term as the regional representative for South Central Pennsylvania here. And as our motto says, our 14,000 members statewide have a mission to conserve, protect, reconnect, and restore the cold water fisheries and their waterways. And you could say that we are the boots on the ground. We're there doing the doing some of this work and coordinating it and getting the work done. In the 9 years since I retired after 30 years in the financial industry, service industry as a certified financial planner, I've dedicated my time, and parenthetically, my wife thinks I have a full-time job, to restoring and caring for the cold water fisheries in Dauphin and Lebanon County. And I'm going to borrow the map that Ann provided you with, that slide, and I took the liberty of putting a circle on that. That's kind of where Lebanon and Dauphin counties serve. And you notice all the red. So we've got our work cut out for us here in central Pennsylvania. Exactly. My chapter received, of course, as a grassroots organization, we depend heavily on the environmental stewardship funds and like pools of money to do our work. And my chapter has received more than $400,000 since 1999 and leveraged $30,000 in matching funds to restore the Spring Creek watershed here in Harrisburg. And this created a wild trout fishery to be enjoyed with local residents here in the Harrisburg area. 3 years ago, my chapter undertook a restoration project on the Lower Snits, which is in Lebanon County. And in the Cleona area of Lebanon County, we restored a third of a mile of section of this creek. For this project, we received a grant from Fish and Boat of $115,000, and we found $50,000 of additional matching funds for buffer, which has been mentioned in this, along the creek, and many, many volunteer hours valued at that $50,000 level. Our chapter has established a strong partnership with many watersheds, and in particular with the Quittapahilla Watershed Association in Annville, Pennsylvania, working on a systematic restoration of the Quittapahilla watershed. And there are currently three projects underway that will restore almost a mile of various tributaries in the watershed. And our chapter is developing plans for two larger watersheds, Spring Creek and Hershey, and you can well imagine the impervious surface that's involved there. That provides a challenge. And in addition to that, the Hammer Creek in eastern Lebanon County. Now, we also anticipate that as these plans mature, we will be making grant applications for funds such as the Environmental Stewardship Funds. Result of all this work will lead to enhancement of habitat for trout, cleaner water in these streams. I always reference a little formula that I kind of joke around with. The formula goes, better habitat, more fish, more fishing fun. Our chapter is not alone in this effort. We have 49 statewide chapters, and they have spent tens of thousands of hours participating in local conservation and education projects. That was just in 2019 so far. Chapters across the state provide educational fishing opportunities for our veterans, introductory courses on fly fishing for women, and kids' fishing days. We really love our work. Partnering with Pennsylvania Fish and Boat and other organizations, we sponsor the Trout in the Classroom program. This program is where a 55-gallon tank is supplied to the school, aeration and cooling equipment to that. And then just recently, we shipped out the fish eggs to the schools. And in this case, the children learn the ins and outs of raising trout. And then in the spring, they go out and release them in a local stream. Really, I've been to a number of those, and it's really a lot of fun. Trout Unlimited also relies on growing greener funds to provide assistance to municipalities. And parenthetically, I work a lot with the municipal groups with their MS4, and we've learned and they realize the biggest bang for their buck is stream restoration because it takes a lot of that pollutant out. In that regard, watershed organizations and conservation districts to clean up more than 200,000 of abandoned mine properties. And as was mentioned before, we still have 287,000 acres and 5,000 miles to clean up yet. Bottom line, recent cuts to these funds that I referred to hurt, and these cuts really need to be restored. Protecting and restoring streams only go so far. Sound legislation to protect our work is just as important. Protecting and restoring our waters after damage occurs is time-consuming and costly. I reference a Senate Bill 619, which changes the definition of pollution by no longer mandating reporting of accidental spills and pollutants that don't have a numeric quality value. In addition, it lets the reporting, as we interpreted, of a spill up to the polluter's discretion. Parenthetic question again, does that make sense? My mind, no. Increases in flooding caused by large-scale changes in climate and land use already caused millions of dollars in damage to our communities and waterways. By stripping our streams of necessary protections and cutting funds to agencies and programs we rely on to protect them, we can assuredly expect more damage in the future. I encourage elected officials in Pennsylvania to consider some of our most important natural resources first, and then protect the clean water at all cost. Remember the formula. Well, I want to add one more element to that formula. Clean water to better habitat, leading to more fish and a whole lot more fishing fun. And you asked a question in one of the previous comments that how do we speak to your colleagues and so forth. We have taken it upon ourselves to invite legislators out to some of our projects to show the hard work that we've done. And I think that we can have a legislative day on the water as that. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I appreciate it.
Hi, thank you, Representative Daley, for inviting me out here, and thank you all for the opportunity to speak. My name's John Kenny. I want to speak to you today about a sport that I love and I've been doing my whole life, which is open water swimming. I live in Conshohocken, which is about 2 miles away from the Schuylkill River. So it's in southeastern Pennsylvania, where we do quite a bit of swimming. I've been on the national team in swims 15 miles and longer. I've won 5 national titles in open water swimming. And I've gone on to train in over, by my estimation, over 500 different bodies of water throughout Pennsylvania and throughout the world, actually. I started French Creek Racing in 2012. We host a variety of events, including triathlons and open water swim events, both in the Schuylkill River and several other rivers, lakes throughout the area. So I want to talk a little bit about perception versus reality, and we look at it from a little bit of a unique perspective in the sense that we are directly in the water. So if anybody's affected by it, it's probably us more than any other user. We've heard from fishermen, we've heard from boaters and kayakers and a variety of other uses, and I rarely ever hear in this type of discussion open water swimming. So. One of our biggest concerns really is access. So people, many people know that navigable waterways, public waterways, you're allowed to swim in. But the question is, where do you get to the access? There's a riparian zone, and whether that's public or private, you may not have permission to do that. Many local municipalities and entities have rules, laws specifically preventing anyone from swimming. However, if you were to take a boat and then jump off the boat, that is permitted. So many places where we've gone, we kind of can't get past the gatekeeper in many cases. We've had a variety of reasons why we've lost venues, new management, conflicts with neighbors, the not in my backyard mentality, land use and zoning, construction and development. So we're always looking for new places to go. We have a lot of criteria that we need, and it's very specific. Obviously, we need clean water, which is why this is so important to us. So we've actually found public or private, it hasn't made much of a difference to whether or not that entity would really speak with us and give us permission. And the best example I can give of the access problem, I don't know if anybody has heard of a woman named Sarah Thomas. She was recently in national news, international news, really, for breaking the world record. She swam the English Channel 4 times consecutively, about 90 miles. She spent over 50 hours in the water. She lives in Colorado, and she was not given a permit to swim in the lake in her hometown. There was an application permit, and they told her, you may not swim here, it's too dangerous. And this is a woman who swam 50 hours straight across the English Channel 4 times. So there's a little bit of a disconnect sometimes, the people making the rules and those who are actually, you know, boots on the ground, so to speak. So one of our big issues, of course, is environmental. And we took a few informal polls about our home river, which is the Schuylkill River. What does this mean to you, swimming on the Schuylkill River? We got answers such as dead bodies, pollution, you know, a whole lot of really negative thoughts. And so there's this stigma surrounding it that this isn't a normal activity that people do. By contrast, we asked the same question about swimming in close proximity to a nuclear plant. We got much, much more positive response to swimming near a nuclear plant. Which the only thing I can really attribute that to is that nuclear is very regulated and controlled. And our bigger issue is wastewater. So sewage treatment plants are often, as he mentioned, dropping pollution in the water and not reporting. So these are things that you can physically see that on some days when you see kind of a stream of sludge coming down the river and you don't know, well, you do know where that came from, the sewage treatment plant. So the reality is also the river has gotten much cleaner. So we've been swimming in the Schuylkill River for about 7 years now, and we've seen the emergence of new wildlife. We've seen a lot of blue herons, beavers, and otters. wildlife that's somewhat sensitive to pollution. And so we've seen this, we've seen a lot of these animals coming back. The other thing which is very notable and people are shocked by is that if you go out in the middle of the day when the sun's high, you can see the bottom. 6 to 8 feet deep, you can see the bottom of the river, so the water clarity is getting better. One other thought that I had along that line, and I have not done any research on this, but perhaps swimming might be a means to help aerate the water. So having swimmers in the water at the surface may increase the oxygen percentage. Scientific research may be prudent there as well. So our other issue then is safety. A lot of these entities steer clear of allowing open water swimming because of the liability. And so the reality of that is that incidents are very rare where anything happens to a swimmer. We require a lot of prerequisites that they're able to swim a certain amount of distance in the pool before we allow them to go into the river. And we've also, our organization, which is fairly small, certified 15 lifeguards this year. We try to maintain about a 15-to-1 ratio between lifeguards and swimmers. So every 15 swimmers, we have at least one lifeguard. So lastly, I want to go over the benefits. And so a lot of people might think, well, what's in it for us to have swimmers? So the reality is that races and events can have a major economic benefit. These are fun, unique events which can contribute to a real great sense of community. Open water in the past 10 to 20 years, open water swimming has trended upward, even while triathlon, which is maybe a more popular sport, has trended downward on that same. So the open water element has become much more popular. From a local standpoint, there's many communities that are trying to activate their waterfront. So if you talk about different ways to activate that waterfront, certainly open water swimming is a great way to do that. So we are generally sharing with other uses, as I mentioned, fishing, boating, kayaking. There's other entities, other users that are using those waterways. And I think in general, this should have support on all sides of the spectrum. So it really is a benefit to everyone that does it, and it really provides no harm. So thank you again for the opportunity, and happy to answer any questions.
Representative Daley?
I want to thank all of you. I realize that we are quickly running out of time, and we're running out of legislators also. It's typical on a Monday morning because we have sessions starting at 1 o'clock. But I really appreciate that each of you raised really significant issues, and I'm hoping that we can count on all of you as resources, because I really think that it's important for us to talk about water and not just the tap water that we're getting. So I'm appreciative of everything that you've added to this conversation. And I don't know, I'm feeling really pressed for time at this point to get into any longer conversations, but I just think that it's really important. And I want to just stress that the reason that I wanted to have Trout Unlimited and my friend John Kenny come and testify is because I think that your organization is not one that we hear from typically. But what you talked about in the work that you're doing, I think one of the things that I really like is that you are working with kids. And I know that my respect and love of the environment came from when I was a Girl Scout and went on camping trips, and we learned about nature and all of that. And I really appreciate it, because I think if you can develop that in children, they remember it as they grow up, and then they hopefully share it with their children. So I think it's just incredibly important. I know John Kenny because he has trained my husband for doing triathlons. So if you don't know that those triathlons, it's really difficult for people to swim in open water. And I know that when you talk about swimming in the Schuylkill, people say, you're swimming in the Schuylkill River. When I was a kid, my dad used to take us, we would walk back to the Schuylkill River, which was a significant hike for us. and we swam there. But then, you know, you also knew that it was, so I don't, it didn't ever harm any of us. But well, as far as I know. But I've gotten to this age without feeling the harm from it. But, you know, so, and I think that people don't always think about, like, swimming in outdoor venues because, you know, that it's not a swimming pool. And it's just fascinating when you listen to people who are actually getting in those rivers and all they have to consider in doing. Jackie, I know that the work that Penn Future does is incredibly important, and I really did appreciate and was really looking forward to this. And John, Jackie actually mentioned the work that you were doing when in our early conversations, and then when I talked to Sarah Inamorato, you know, I'm just really glad that you were able to be here. And so you gave us something, I think, to share with our colleagues, those of who were able to stay, but we will continue this conversation because it, as I said in the beginning, and I really appreciate that we have such wealth of water in this state. I think I'm mostly appreciative that you raise the issues that, when I said to you, I feel like I talk about water and I think about water all of the time, and I just worry about it because I've seen the Delaware River Basin Commission be attacked, and I've seen the Susquehanna River Basin Commission be attacked, although the last meeting was so amicable that I nearly fell off my chair, which I'm grateful for, but I think that that is, you know, a tribute to the work that they're doing and being able to emphasize the importance because, and I agree with the idea that you have to take care of it now, and $324 million sounds really monstrously large amount of money, but I'm telling you, I really like the idea of a flush fund too. Mm-hmm. And so I think that we'll have things to talk about, and so I just want to say thank you again to all of you.
If I could just also follow up on that a little bit, you know, I think one of the reasons why perhaps we have a tendency to take our water for granted in Pennsylvania is because we do have such a concentration of water. And I always say to colleagues, you know, go west of the Mississippi and see whether somebody will give you water for free. And, you know, they fight wars over it out west of the Mississippi. And here it's just like, yeah, sure, go ahead, take that one. I don't care. You know, throw your pollution in there. There's more over here. And that's, I think, we're starting to get to a point where, you know, after the initial reaction years ago when we saw rivers on fire and things like that, I think we've sort of then said, okay, we took care of all that, right? There's not a problem anymore. And we know that there is, and it's a matter of trying to get the sort of consciousness back up about this before we get to a point where our rivers are catching on fire again. I will point out that all of the testimony today, if you submitted written testimony or if you want to submit your written testimony, will be posted on our website for anyone to see. And then we're also going to try and make sure that we get this information out. I think this has been recorded, so we can stream this out. And hopefully we can continue elevating the discussion about this issue. So thank you, Representative Daley, and thank you all for testifying today.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thanks.